happy holidays and stuff.
Yes.
Last day of the show. Last day of the gallery for the year. We'll be closed for the year. And what better way to wrap it up with some things that may be helpful at some point by David Fullerton. So we're not presenting you with a slideshow.
No, we're not.
No PowerPoints. We're just going to chat. And if you guys have questions throughout, you're welcome to raise your hand. And David can ask as we go.
Sure.
Many of you may know David. For those of you who don't, maybe he can give himself a little intro as well. We've been showing David's work for quite a while. This is his third solo show with us.
It is,
right?
Yeah.
I think it is.
Yeah.
This is, what, about 18 months of work?
Yeah, because the last one was January 2016.
Yes, it was.
So it was about 18 months of work.
And the one of the things we were talking about, David doesn't necessarily do a body of work and say, overarching theme of like, this is my next show. This is the last 18 months of our social anxieties put down on paper.
Which is why it's hard. I don't really like doing these things because I don't really have, like, this is a show about this. It's just like, this is a continuation of what I do all the time. So it makes it hard to sort of talk about it.
Yeah, well, sort of. David makes it really clear what he's trying to get across with his pieces. He uses text and words.
Right.
So. With that, I believe we're done.
Thank you for coming.
So why don't you introduce yourself a little, David? Where you come from and how'd you get into all this?
I'm David Fullerton. I'm from Scotland. I've been doing this for a long time. I went to art school in Edinburgh. And I've lived over here since 1995. I didn't actually do this when I moved over here. I'd kind of given up, left art school. Went to early art school in 1984 and didn't have a fantastic final experience at art school, so I actually gave up doing all this stuff until I moved over here. So I had like a 10-year gap where I didn't really do anything. And then when I moved to San Francisco, I kind of got reinvigorated with the whole thing and started doing it again. Although I didn't really show anything until 2002, I think it was, something around about there. So I've only really been doing it since 2002.
Nice.
Yeah.
What brought, when you came to San Francisco, what kind of reinvigorated you and got you back
just
into
being
it?
In the, at that time, I mean, it's changed so much now. Like, the city was like, there was, everybody you met was doing something.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
You kind of felt like I wanted to do something other than just the day job. So
sure.
Got me going again. I actually had more time on my hands too, because I was looking for work.
Cool.
So I started painting again.
And before that, you were painting?
It was mostly painting, yeah.
Yeah.
The first painting took about a year to do. I just kept doing it over and over again until I finally got somewhere and I kind of took it from there. I didn't, that's when I first started properly using text as well. I did a little bit at college in my final year, which was kind of a disaster.
Text.
They really hated it. And
really?
The tutors hated it. Yeah.
Or they discouraged it?
They discouraged it. They didn't like it. No, I was supposed to be doing expressionists, so, angst-ridden Scottish painting, really brown colours.
Muddy landscapes.
Yeah, exactly. I did really well in my third year, and then my final year, when I started using text, I was kind of frowned upon. And my final show was in like this attic room where nobody could find it. So,
You think if you stayed in Scotland, you'd be.
I don't know, I've often wondered that.
Could you
actually
fight off that? You know,
I don't know. It was kind of liberating for me to come over here and just feel like I can start again and do something. And it was also being here made me feel more like kind of legitimizes me kind of outside of regular. I'm foreign, so I can.
That's right, you can get away with it.
With
exactly. It's exotic. What's that?
Speak a little louder.
Oh,
sorry.
Can't hear us back
then?
Yeah. You gotta come a little closer.
There's a microphone here.
In talking about the show as a whole and kind of putting the show and living with it, it's been up for quite a while now.
Yeah.
I've really, you know, obviously absorbed all the work and everybody that comes in has really enjoyed the work. It's a fun show in that it's a show that people can, you know, they spend like half hour, an hour in here. They want to read everything. They want to kind of take it all in. It's almost like, you know, a graphic novel, like a story being read throughout, even though they don't necessarily communicate with one another, but they do, you know, have an overarching
That's right. That's why I did it.
Yeah.
People will stay longer.
That's right.
Read the words.
Yeah.
That's the.
But I don't know. What we were saying, it's important to comment on the social anxiety
right.
we all have.
We were
right
talking
now.
Earlier about this, and
yeah.
Like, and my wife, who's sitting right here, said mm-hmm. the other day, like, there's a lot of social commentary, and I was kind of thinking, like, I don't really feel there's any more social commentary than there ever was in any other shows.
Sure.
But I think that the social commentary has become, because there's a lot of it is about the absurdity of modern existence.
Mm-hmm.
And as the last year,
mm-hmm.
18 months, have become more absurd than anyone could ever have imagined,
mm-hmm.
it's kind of like met the kind
yeah.
of absurdity
exactly.
of the work. And it's
yeah.
like, okay, that's why people are resonating, because
yeah.
it's like, I've always done this, but now it's like, oh yeah, that really is.
Here
we
it
were
is.
Just talking about that. We did the last show, we did this piece here, which seems really ridiculous now. Which the headline
this
is
like,
way
out
yeah,
time,
this
and
is
that's
like,
why
this
I still
is
have
like,
it.
This was done about 2.5 years ago about the Russian mafia. The Russian mafia are no longer just in Russia, they're in your neighborhood and are plotting against you. And it's like, well, like, okay, that's kind of scary.
I mean,
that
it was
like,
practically a sold out show, but we had this piece because
right.
this was too
And then
too,
there's a list,
far
of,
ahead.
A list of other anxieties
yeah.
for you to worry about, which are also very.
He's kind of mocking us, right?
He
now.
Is mocking us.
He's mocking
more
us.
Now than ever.
More now
so
than
do you remember
ever.
Where you got the idea for that?
No, it was at the time it seemed like such a stupid thing to say. Like the Russian mafia are in your neighborhood. And they're, you know, it's like, ha, ha, ha. Except
so it wasn't like you didn't read
anymore.
Anything?
No,
you
it wasn't. It was just one of those things. It's like, you know.
Or you weren't a part of it? I mean, were,
yeah.
were you the problem?
Inside.
Oh my God, you found it
emotionally. Yes.
Are you conspiring, David?
You'll find out.
This is a really fine piece.
What's that?
So, this is a nice piece.
Yeah.
But,
still for sale? 10%
this yeah. yeah. There's a few pieces that are, they really point the finger, you know, a particular individual. Well, there's one.
Right, I mean, there's the Trump one, which was, I was kind of struggling with
it.
That. I kind of had
you
to
had
do
to
it,
do
I kind
it.
Of didn't want to do it.
You had to do it.
And in the end, I think that one, I ended up doing it because it's, to me, it's not as much about Trump. That piece is about, like, how I don't understand other people's perception of him. Like, to me, it's just like, how can tens of millions of Americans vote for him? I just don't, it's beyond my comprehension that they look at him and see something which is so completely different
yeah.
from wild, and that's really what that piece was about.
Sure. That's what we're all up against,
like,
right?
I just don't get it. So.
Still even now?
Yeah,
even
now?
Yeah.
I'm
working
now, I still can't believe that it's actually...
I try and, you know, pretend like I can understand it.
I mean, I understand bits of it, but I don't really understand it. No.
There's another really nice piece with the guys in the little cars.
Right.
Talk about that.
I don't know what I possibly say about that.
Yeah, it says
know.
It all.
I mean, that's
yeah.
actually something that I had written down in a sketchbook for mm-hmm. years, and then I was going through stuff, and I was like, "Oh, that would be kind of a good one to do right now." And then,
yeah.
but, I mean, I don't know. That's just one of those things that I wrote down at some point, and I don't know, really know where it came from. So a lot of the stuff's like that. A lot of the stuff is like I've got books full of phrases and stuff that
mm-hmm.
are all in there, and then. That's where it comes. So a lot of the stuff is not new. It's like it's been kicking around for a while.
Mm-hmm.
I just kind of execute it.
Because each piece, you kind of have your own idea, your own concept that's going on. It's not like an expressionistic continuity of how you're feeling that day. I mean, there are distinct thoughts.
Yeah,
so,
are.
And you're a writer.
Yeah.
You're a copywriter as well.
Too,
so you write this stuff down in a journal.
Yeah.
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 And then revisit it.
I just keep it, and then like I'll mm-hmm. go, I'll re-look through books and go like, oh yeah, I'll do this.
Yeah, like, that's
like, sometimes I'll see an image and go like, oh, I remember I've got a line that would work really well with that, and I'll put it together like that.
Nice.
That's kind of how it works.
Henry, I saw your picture here.
I'm fascinated. You were doing this in Scotland, which is a really cool thing to hear. I'm talking to a transplanted artist who's kind of fully formed and then showed up here.
Well, I wasn't really fully formed in Scotland, no.
You were already, you were painting.
I was painting, yeah, but I wasn't really doing this kind of painting.
So that answered one question for me. I think you're a painter because your graphite work was stunning on these little paintings. On
yeah.
Little, on these larger assemblies, right?
Right.
But did the sense of mockery and mundanity get started in the UK?
Oh yeah, totally. Yeah.
is that a game?
It's definitely a Scottish perspective. It's
yeah.
that kind of dark
really?
Sort of. Self-depreciating humor, yeah. Yeah.
You preceded a US predicament.
Yes.
social media.
Yeah.
Right.
Cool. It is cool. Yeah, it's a good point because you brought that sensibility to our predicament.
I did. Hopefully it didn't cause that predicament. I feel responsibly saying.
No.
Yeah.
Hey folks, you have a question?
What made you decide to start using text?
I don't know. I've always like Matt said. I kind of make a living as a copywriter, so I've always used. And when I was in school, I've always been good at like writing good English. I don't enjoy writing very much. I enjoy drawing. I was probably better at writing than I was at drawing, but because I enjoy drawing more, I've kind of persevered with that and become better at it. Whereas the writing, I don't really enjoy. So when I started doing art again, I kind of it was just a natural thing to start using a combination of text and images. And also because I worked in advertising for a long time, and that's basically what you do. I was a copywriter and I worked with an art director, and when you make an ad, you're basically combining words and pictures, and that's kind of, you know, that was kind of what I was doing anyway, and I was playing a little bit more extremely with that format. I mean, these could be a lot of could be ads.
So you sort of alluded to, like, maybe you'll just see an image somewhere in your collection or wherever,
right,
and then that triggers you to sort of start the process of making.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of.
Or is it anxiety of the day?
Sometimes. I mean, I write stuff down a lot, so it's just like, and then I'll have like a store of things that are written down, and then I'll see an image, or I'll figure out an image, or something that just kind of marries the two. Quite often, I'll try something and it's a disaster, and then I'll just go back and do something else. There's a lot of, I mean, a lot of them look like that because they're reworked a lot. I don't just sit down and go like, oh, I'll do this and that, and then it works.
Right.
Usually, it doesn't work. Usually, I have to try it again in a different way. Yes.
So can I ask what's probably a dumb question?
Yeah.
There's a lot of text on all of these, but then there's
right.
also crossed out text.
Yeah.
Does the crossing out, is that, do you know you're going to cross it out? Or do you, is it crossed out before you put it on? Or do
yes,
you
it's probably completely contrived. Some of
that's
it,
not part of
if
the
it happens,
editing.
If
the
it
editing.
Happens organically, then I'll keep it, but then sometimes I'll take a look at the cross
yeah.
things out. Yeah.
It looks pretty neurotic, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially right now.
Yeah. With Rook, we have some anonymous comments as well.
Oh, cool.
With this conversation, I'd like to add this new question for you. How would your art change if you lost the power of language?
Oh my God. I see like drawings of weird looking people. No, to be honest with you, the whole thing is a combination of.
Uh-huh.
I've never done, since I started doing this, I've never done a piece that didn't have text on it. I don't think, I'm pretty sure I haven't. So I mean, that's really, for me, the image is, the text is part of the image, so I don't know. I mean, I probably wouldn't do it if I couldn't use language, yeah, do
fishing.
Something else, yeah. Right.
Yes.
I wonder if you could draw first the images,
and
then you add the text, or do you think?
Well, so I sort of usually start out with an idea of, I've got the text and I want to make the piece using the text, and then I'll do the images. Although sometimes I'll just sit down and draw a thing. So it doesn't, there's not really, probably more often I start out with the text and then draw the image to go with the text, but sometimes I'll just do a drawing and then figure it out as I'm going. So it's not really a rule.
The studio is kind of reflective of this process. So I've had the pleasure of visiting. You know,
right.
Lots of things in progress.
Nice.
Yeah,
yeah.
There's just stuff happening.
Right, there's a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah, there's images up on the wall. There's,
right.
But it seems like this format is your comfortable format for you, drawing, you know, round, yay big.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, I used to do stuff that was more like this, but it was much, much bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And it just took a really long time to do it. It took me months to do one of those things, and I just got kind of sick of. I started doing the smaller drawings because I'd get kind of stuck on a big painting, so I'd do the smaller drawings, which were easier and they were more complete and faster.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just concentrated on those and kind of stopped doing those big ones. Plus, nobody ever buys them. As you know, because there's lots of them.
We have some large ones, yeah.
Yeah.
We can
talk a little bit about the lists.
The lists. The lists were kind of unintentional. I didn't really mean to do this for the show or anything. I started one of them, I think it was Ernesto's Christmas list. It was actually a real list that I had.
A found list?
Yeah, it was a found list, and it was great. I didn't have Ernesto's Christmas list, it was just a list of shit. And I, so then I made it into that. And then when I was doing that, I just really enjoyed the process of doing that. And then I sort of got carried away and just kept doing them. And I wasn't intending to really like show them like this. I was just going to do them. Again, it was kind of like a little break from what I was doing. Like I just do them and I could do like a bunch and be like, oh, this is great. I feel really productive and creative, even though. And then, so that was kind of how that came about. And I was just going to stick them all in the forestry files and let people like root around and buy them. And then when the show came off, I started to really like them. Some of them are just obviously like, you know, Gherkin 28 times. But some of them are kind of good because some of them are kind of like little stories. If you go through them, they kind of suggest a bigger story around about them and stuff like that. So they were kind of fun to do. But there wasn't any, you know, great theory behind them. Yeah.
What's so your practice is a little bit like this flow, and then you sort of pick things out and show them, like you don't do discrete bodies of work. So
yeah, I mean, I did that one show, which was the Apologies one.
Yeah.
And again, that was one where I was kind of stuck, and I just was like, I need to do something that's going to get me out of this. So I did the whole Apologies series, and it kind of became like a, because it was a formula, I kind of like worked through the everything and that.
Right.
But then we got,
yeah, so what I wonder is, like, when I look at different ones, they seem to have different voices.
Right.
Like, it's something I'm trying to figure out is, like, who is speaking in each
one.
I wonder if you have a sense of, if it's just
kind
this
of
big
cacophony
in your head, or do you think it's,
right.
like, I don't know.
It's not a real, it's not me, for sure. And if you notice, a lot of them are plural. There's like we. I like to use the we. I don't know if there's
mm-hmm.
a word for that or what it is.
Sure.
Plural
the,
or something
the,
like that. So
it's
we.
It's like the voice of authority saying this is how it is.
It's like we is like a shared
it's
sort of.
Shared.
Thing. Yeah, I don't know what. There's something about that that's just it's kind of more inclusive.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like we are commenting on. But it's not me. It's like, oh, it's weird.
Mm-hmm.
Some kind of weird me.
Do you think you're like ventriloquizing?
Kind of, yeah, a little bit.
Or are you trying
yeah.
to just honestly like look at someone's face and try to
no.
figure out what they're thinking?
No, it's more like ventriloquizing.
Putting words in their
mouth.
Like.
Yeah, because we were going to do it.
Yeah, we were going to do a ventriloquist on me.
Yeah, right. It's kind of like
we
you're using a voice,
it.
Like
yeah.
it's not my voice to do something. Yeah.
Okay.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
I have another anonymous question,
okay.
two of them actually. When did the madness start?
Oh no, it's getting worse. Yeah, it's kind of worse.
Do you have vivid dreams?
Yeah, I do sometimes, yeah.
Really?
No, and they're usually not very pleasant as well.
Like what?
I have at least let's say I wake up screaming sometimes. I have this dream about being chased by a really big teddy bear.
Yeah.
And it's usually inside a movie theater as well.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, like those ones people give for gifts, the big floppy ones?
No, like a regular size teddy bear.
Just
giant. Like, huge, yeah.
That's
yeah.
Cool.
That's
awful.
I don't know what that
I haven't
means.
Seen that in your work yet. Yeah.
Well, there's bears, some things do appear.
Well, the Russian bear.
Right, yeah.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Any other questions again? Jane?
Is there an era of ephemera that you're most interested in?
You mean to use as like
yeah,
material?
Kind of where do you get this stuff? Like,
yeah, I mean, I like the idea. I like used paper and stuff because it's got that whole story of like where did you know when you get something and it's got somebody else's stuff written on it, you're kind of like already have a head start on
mm-hmm.
what it is. I just find it in all kinds of places. People now give it to me. They like hand you here's a whole bunch of
your
stuff.
TV repair manuals.
At least I was delighted when I come home with it. Yeah, like a stack of TV repair manuals and stuff like that. So yeah, I don't know. It comes, but it's like, and I hate when you've got like something new and pristine. It's super intimidating, and you've got like a bunch of plus the texture and also the. I mean, my palette basically is now all pieces of paper and stuff. That's what it's become.
Well, you found a medium to express yourself with. Which is
right.
part of the challenge. Like a blank canvas
is
awful and intimidating.
Right. And there's something about using like old office stationery and old, you know, that
mm-hmm.
old.
Has some history
yeah,
already
has
to
that.
It.
There's sort of implications behind that as well.
Sure, sure.
Where, what it is and where it came from.
Mm-hmm. It's your medium.
Which we won't go into.
It's the paper and the graphite.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yep. Henry had his hand up again.
Henry.
I guess I was going to say, is your strategy to borrow the familiar?
T- To do what?
Borrow the familiar.
Well, a lot of your imagery, like say you look for your components, and does familiarity attract you to them?
I don't know, it's hard to say, because sometimes I just see some, it's like almost like when you hear about music and like that's right, it's just like a kind of feeling of rightness when you see something. But maybe it's familiar, I don't know. It's one of those things, you just look at something and you're like, oh yeah, that's I'm gonna use that, that's right. So I don't know, it's hard to analyze that stuff.
Yeah, that particular image just serves the mission you're on with that.
Yeah,
okay.
Right.
That's a good point though. I mean, the people you use are they're ordinary individuals, looking individuals.
Kind of,
people
yeah,
you
yeah.
come across,
right.
you know,
yeah.
every day, that you don't always see that in art
yeah.
or
right.
media or, you know, your
That
mode.
Was one of the things that was weird using Donald Trump, because it's like, I don't really want to draw somebody as
yeah.
sort of recognizable. And the implications of that
yeah.
are like everybody knows who that is, and that kind of cuts down the meaning in a way, because it's like this person has a meaning who they are, and everybody brings that perception
mm-hmm.
to. Whereas if you're just
yeah,
looking
exactly.
at a face, you don't know who it is, you bring your own meaning to that face.
Sure. It's important. You ever notice if you're watching a news channel or something and they're interviewing an ordinary citizen who's not a TV celebrity, they look so normal.
Yeah.
Or kind of odd, even, because
right.
you're not used to
yeah,
looking
yeah.
at normal people. So that's, you know, you got that a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
You're like, oh yeah, I feel like I've seen that guy before.
Yeah, yeah, you get that. That happens a lot. Yeah.
Any other thoughts you'd like to share with Mr. Fullerton?
I'd like you to start a men's group.
That sounds like a nightmare.
Yeah, that'd be awful.
How many people would happen in that?
Yeah, what would go on there?
Or at least they should be in your show.
Oh, really? Why do you think, what would be the benefit of that?
Well, like, what about, I mean, like, there's so much imagery of women. Like, people like to look at women.
Oh, right.
You're living in a male-driven world that I am very interested in.
Right. I know, it's funny, because someone said to me the other day about, like, you don't use a lot of women, and it's true, and I think it's because of that, like, it's about men, it's about like that whole attitude. Yeah, it is kind of like
sure,
that.
Sure.
Yeah.
Speaking of that, I have another question.
Oh, no,
relevant to that, I mean, maybe, to what degree does your mother influence your art?
I hope she's watching, still isn't.
She's probably asleep just
now. I don't know, my mother and father are both baffled by the whole thing.
Really?
Yeah, like, they don't find it really. I mean, they're very supportive.
Sure.
No, they weren't to start out with.
Really?
But I mean, I don't think they kind of thing, yeah.
Yeah.
My dad actually said to me once, we were in a gallery in Palo Alto,
uh-huh.
where I just started to show stuff again.
Uh-huh.
And he actually turned and was like, I have no idea who my son is.
Was he there?
So I thought that was kind of an achievement.
So what happened?
Yeah.
Do they follow you though, your art?
Yeah, they do.
And
they're actually like, and they pass comment on. They generally
mm-hmm.
like it. And you know, I think like you either get it or you don't get it.
Sure.
I think they kind of get it.
Sure.
And they, I mean, it's the sense of humor. They definitely understand that.
Sure. You're making them proud with the sense of humor.
I don't know. I am who I am.
Yeah. Cool. Thank you, everyone. Any other thoughts?
Yeah.
Otherwise, we can wrap it up and hang out in the gallery and have some tea and snacks. And we're here till 7, so take your time.
Cool.
And David's going to be hanging around too.
Yeah.
You can ask him questions in private. You can
yeah. These are always the best.
Yeah. Well, thanks again, David, for
yeah.
another
yeah.
fantastic
thank
show.
You.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank
you.
I like that.
Yeah.